The Devoted Friend by Oscar Wilde. One morning the old water rat put his head out of his hole. He had bright, beady eyes and stiff gray whiskers, and his tail was like a long bit of black India rubber. The little ducks were swimming about in the pond, and their mother was trying to teach them to stand on their heads in the water. "You will never be in the best society unless you can stand on your head," she kept saying to them. But the little ducks paid no attention to her. They were too young to know the advantages of being in society. "What disobedient children," cried the old water rat. "They deserve to be drowned." "Oh," said the mother duck, "everyone must make a beginning, and parents must be patient." "Well, I know nothing about the feelings of parents," said the water rat. "I'm not a family man myself. I've never been married, and I don't intend to be. Love is all very well in its way, but friendship, ah, friendship is much higher. I know of nothing in the world that is rarer or nobler than a devoted friendship." "And what, pray, is your idea of the duties of a devoted friend?" asked the little grey linnet, who was sitting on a willow tree and had overheard the conversation.
"What a silly question," answered the water rat. "I should expect my devoted friend to be devoted to me, of course."
"And what would you do in return?" said the little bird.
"I don't understand you," answered the water rat.
"Well, let me tell you a story," said the linnet, and he flew down, and alighting upon the bank, he told the story of the devoted friend. "Once there was an honest little fellow named Hans," said the linnet, "with a kind heart and a funny, round, good-humoured face, and he lived in a tiny cottage all by himself, and every day he worked in his garden, and in all the countryside there was no garden so lovely as his. Sweet williams grew there, and shepherd's purses, and there were damask roses and lilac crocuses, and gold purple violets, and white, and marjoram, and the flower de luce, and daffodils. They blossomed in their order as the months went by, so that there were always beautiful things to look at, and pleasant odors to smell. Little Hans had many friends, but the most devoted friend of all was Big Hugh the Miller. Indeed, so devoted was the rich miller to little Hans that he would never go by his garden without leaning over the wall and plucking a large nosegay or a handful of sweet herbs. Real friends should have everything in common, the miller used to say, and little Hans nodded and smiled, for he was very proud of having a friend with such noble ideas. Sometimes the neighbors thought it strange that the rich miller never gave little Hans anything in return, though he had 100 sacks of flour stored away in his mill, and 6 cows, and a large flock of woolly sheep. But Hans never troubled his head about these things, and nothing gave him greater pleasure than to listen to all the wonderful things the miller used to say about the unselfishness of true friendship. So little Hans worked away in his garden. During the spring, the summer, and the autumn, he was very happy. But when the winter came, and he had no flowers to take to market, he suffered a good deal from cold and hunger, and often had to go to bed without any supper. In the winter also, he was extremely lonely, as the miller never came to see him then. "There's no good in my going to see little Hans as long as the snow lasts," the miller used to say to his wife. "When people are in trouble, they should be left alone and not be bothered by visitors. So I shall wait till the spring comes. Then he will be able to give me a large basket of primroses, and that will make him so happy." "You are certainly very thoughtful about others," answered the miller's wife, as she sat in a comfortable armchair by the big fire. "It's quite a treat to hear you talk about friendship." "Why, if little Hans came up here," said the miller, "and saw this warm fire and our good supper, he might get envious. And envy is the most terrible thing. No, I certainly will not allow Hans' nature to be spoiled. I am his best friend." "Is that the end of the story?" asked the water rat. "Oh, no," answered the linnet.
"Well, every good storyteller today starts with the end, then goes to the beginning. That is the new method," said the water rat. "I heard all about it the other day from a critic who was walking around the pond with a young man. He must have been right, for whenever the young man made any remark, he always answered, 'Pooh!' But pray go on with your story. I like the miller immensely."
"Well," said the linnet, hopping now on one leg and then on the other, As soon as the winter was over and the primroses began to open their pale yellow stars, the miller told his wife that he would go down now and see little Hans. "Mind you take the big basket with you," she said. So the miller went down the hill with his basket on his arm. "Good morning, little Hans," he said. "Good morning," said Hans, leaning on his spade and grinning from ear to ear. "And how have you been all the winter?" asked the miller. "Oh, it is very good of you to ask. Very good indeed," cried Hans. "I'm afraid I had rather a hard time of it, but now the spring has come, and all my flowers are doing well, and..." "We talked of you and wondered how you were getting on," said the miller. "Oh, that was kind of you," said Hans. "I was half afraid you'd forgotten me." "I'm surprised at you, Hans," said the miller. "Friendship never forgets. How lovely your primroses are looking, by the by." "Yes, they are lovely," said Hans. "And it is most lucky for me that I have so many, for I am going to take them to the market and sell them and buy back my wheelbarrow with the money." "Buy back your wheelbarrow? You don't mean to say you've sold it. What a very stupid thing to do."
"Well, the fact is," said Hans, "that I was obliged to. You see, the winter was a very bad time for me, and I really had no money at all to buy bread with, so I first sold the silver buttons off my Sunday coat, and then I sold my big pipe, and at last I sold my wheelbarrow. But I'm going to buy them all back again now."
"Hans," said the miller, "I will give you my wheelbarrow. It's not in very good repair. Indeed, one side is gone, and there's something wrong with the wheels, but in spite of that, I will give it to you. I know it's very generous of me, and a great many people would think me extremely foolish for parting with it, but I'm not like the rest of the world. I think that generosity is the essence of friendship. Besides, I've got a new wheelbarrow for myself." "Oh, that is generous of you," said little Hans, and his funny round face glowed all over with pleasure. "I can easily put it in repair, as I have a plank of wood in the house." "A plank of wood," said the miller. "Why, that is just what I want for the roof of my barn. There's a very large hole in it, and the corn will get damp if I don't stop it up." "How lucky you mentioned it. It's quite remarkable how one good action always breeds another. I have given you my wheelbarrow. Now you're giving me your plank. Of course, the wheelbarrow is worth far more than the plank. But true friendship never notices things like that. Pray get it at once, and I will set out to work at my barn this very day." "Certainly," cried little Hans, and he ran into the shed and dragged the plank out. "It is not a very big plank," said the miller. "I'm afraid after I've mended my barn roof, there won't be anything left for you to mend the wheelbarrow with. But, of course, this is not my fault. And now, as I've given you my wheelbarrow, I'm sure you would like to give me some flowers in return. Here's the basket, and mind you fill it quite full."
"Quite full," said little Hans, rather sorrowfully, for it was really a very big basket, and he knew that if he filled it, he would have no flowers left for the market.
"Well, really," said the miller, "as I've given you my wheelbarrow, I don't think it's much to ask you for a few flowers. I should have thought that true friendship was quite free from selfishness of any kind."
"Oh, my dear friend, my best friend," cried little Hans, "you are welcome to all the flowers in my garden." And he ran and plucked all his pretty primroses and filled the miller's basket.
"Goodbye," said the miller to little Hans. And he went up the hill with the plank on one shoulder, the big basket in his hand. "Goodbye," said little Hans. And he began to dig away quite merrily. He was so pleased about the wheelbarrow. The next day he was nailing up some honeysuckle against the porch when he heard the miller's voice calling to him from the road. So he jumped off the ladder and ran down the garden and looked over the wall. There was the miller with a large sack of flour on his back. "Dear little Hans," said the miller, "would you mind carrying this sack of flour for me to market?"
"Well, I am very busy today. I've got all my creepers to nail up and all my flowers to water and all my grass to roll."
"Well, really," said the miller, "I think that considering I'm giving you my wheelbarrow, it is rather unfriendly of you to refuse."
"Oh, don't say that," cried little Hans. "I wouldn't be unfriendly for the whole world." And he ran for his cap and trudged off with a big sack over his shoulders. It was a very hot day, and the road was terribly dusty. and before Hans had reached the fourth milestone, he had to sit down and rest. However, at last he reached the market and sold the flour for a very good price and returned home very tired. "Oh, it has certainly been a hard day," he said to himself as he was going to bed. "But I'm glad I did not refuse my very best friend who is going to give me his wheelbarrow." And early next morning, the miller came down to get the money for a sack of flour. But little Hans was so tired, he was still in bed. "Upon my word," said the miller, "you are very lazy. Considering that I'm going to give you my wheelbarrow, I think you might work harder. Idleness is a great sin. I don't really like any of my friends to be idle or sluggish. Oh, you must not mind my speaking quite plainly to you. Of course, I should not dream of doing so if I were not your friend. But what is the good of friendship if one cannot say exactly what one means?" "I'm very sorry," said little Hans, "but I thought I would lie in bed just for a little and listen to the birds singing. I always work harder after hearing the birds sing." "Ah, I'm glad of that," said the miller, slapping little Hans on the back, "for I want you to come up to the mill as soon as you're dressed and mend my barn roof for me." Poor little Hans had not watered his flowers for 2 days. "Would you think it unfriendly of me if I said I was busy?" he inquired in a shy, timid voice. "Well, really," answered the miller, "it's not much to ask, considering that I'm giving you my wheelbarrow. Of course, if you refuse, I'll go and do it myself." "Oh, no," cried little Hans, and he jumped out of bed and dressed himself and went up to the barn. He worked there all day long, till sunset. And at sunset, the miller came to see how he was getting on. "Ah," said the miller, "no work is so delightful as the work one does for others. At present, you have only the practice of friendship, but one day you will have the theory also." "Oh, do you really think I shall?" asked little Hans. "I have no doubt of it. But now that you've mended the roof, you'd better get some rest, for I want you to drive my sheep to the mountains tomorrow." Early the next morning, the miller brought his sheep round to the cottage, and Hans went off with them to the mountain. It took him the whole day to get there and back, and when he returned, he was so tired he fell asleep in his chair, and somehow he was never able to look after his flowers, for his friend the miller was always coming round, sending him off on errands or getting him to help the mill. Hans was very afraid his flowers would think he'd forgotten them, but he could not refuse his best friend. "Besides," he said, "he's going to give me his wheelbarrow, and that is pure generosity." So little Hans worked away for the miller, and the miller said all kinds of beautiful things about friendship. And it happened that one evening little Hans was sitting by his fireside when a loud rap came at the door. It was a very wild night, and the wind was blowing and roaring around the house, and there stood the miller with a lantern. "Dear little Hans," he said, "I'm in great trouble. My little boy has fallen off a ladder and hurt himself, and the doctor lives so far away, and it's such a bad night, and it occurred to me that as I'm going to give you my wheelbarrow, that it's only fair that you might do something for me in return." "Oh, certainly," cried little Hans. "I take it as a great compliment your coming to me." Well, the night was so black that little Hans could hardly see, and the wind was so strong that he could hardly stand. And after he'd been walking 3 hours, he arrived at the doctor's house and knocked at the door. "Who's there?" cried the doctor. "Little Hans," he answered. "The miller's son is hurt, and the miller wishes you to come right away." "Very well," said the doctor, and he ordered his horse and rode off in the direction of the miller's house, with little Hans trudging behind. But the storm grew worse and worse, and the rain fell in torrents, and Hans could not see where he was going. And he finally lost his way, and he wandered off on the moor, which was a very dangerous place, full of deep holes. And there, poor little Hans was drowned. Everybody went to his funeral, and the miller was the chief mourner. "I was his best friend," said the miller. "It is only fair that I should have the best place." And he wiped his eyes with a very big pocket handkerchief. "A great loss, a great loss," he murmured. "Why, I had as good as given him my wheelbarrow, and now I really don't know what to do with it. It's in such bad repair that I could not get anything for it if I sold it. I will certainly take care not to give anything away again.
one certainly suffers for being generous.
Well, said the water rat, after a long pause.
Well,
that is the end, said the linnet.
But what became of the miller? Asked the water rat.
Oh, I really don't know, replied the linnet. I'm afraid you don't quite see the moral of the story.
The moral? Screamed the water rat. Well, really, I think you should have told me that before you began. If you had done so, I certainly would have said, Pooh! However, I can say it now. So he shouted out, Pooh! At the top of his voice, gave a whisk of his tail, and went back into his hole.